Crypto as an asset class is highly volatile. It's for people with a high tolerance for risk and who understand they can lose the entire value of their investment. Crypto may be more susceptible to market manipulation than securities. Crypto is not insured by the FDIC or protected by the Securities Investor Protection Corporation. Also, investors in crypto do not benefit from the same regulatory protections applicable to registered securities like stocks or bonds. Fidelity Crypto is offered by Fidelity Digital Assets. Brokerage accounts and securities trading are provided by Fidelity Brokerage Services, which does not offer crypto as a direct investment or provide trading or custody service for such assets. Throughout this live stream, you may hear terms like cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and many more. Keep in mind, the digital asset space is vast. Flowing, interactive conversations like this one may use words like crypto or digital assets as substitution terms for specific coins or for the ecosystem as a whole. Remember, all coins and tokens have very different attributes and use cases, and the ones we talk about here are only part of a wide variety of digital assets in existence. Lots and lots of choices these days for someone who wants exposure to cryptocurrencies. And sometimes, as you probably already figured out, those choices can get confusing. Thanks for joining us for this episode of the Covering Crypto live stream. I'm Jim Armstrong with Fidelity. Today, we are focused on the questions that you have sent in about buying and selling digital assets themselves and their derivatives. We've got two amazing guests who will answer those questions today. Brian Allen is Product Area Leader with Fidelity Digital Assets, and Sophie Gachijan is a Vice President with the Fidelity Institutional Digital Assets team. Thanks to both of you for joining us.
Hi, happy to be here.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having us.
Sure thing. Sydney Wilson is with us today as well. She's also on the Fidelity Digital Assets team, and her role in today's broadcast is to help us get to as many live viewer questions as we can. Hey, Sid.
Hi, Jim. Thanks so much. So today we're going to start by answering some excellent viewer questions that folks sent in when you registered. You can also send your questions to us right now. So if you look just to the right of the video player, you can submit your questions and upvote others that look interesting. Just remember though, we can't give price predictions for any cryptocurrency. Sometimes we get hundreds, sometimes thousands of questions, so I likely won't be able to get to them all today. I'll look for common themes and I'll get to as many as we can. For those we can't get to today though, please visit fidelity.com/learncrypto. You may be able to find your answer there.
Love it. Thanks, Ed. We'll check back in with you in just a few minutes. But as you said, we did build today's entire conversation around questions that, customers have already sent in as well. So we can start with this one from Michael, who wrote in when he registered and said, please cover the different ways one can invest in crypto, which is like a perfect place to start because there are, as I said, off the top of the show, a growing number of ways to invest. So broadly speaking, there are three major ways someone can get exposure to the digital assets industry and to cryptocurrencies themselves right now. And that's what we'll be talking about today. First, you can buy coins or tokens directly. Next is through the purchase of an exchange-traded product, ETP, or exchange-traded fund, ETF. And then finally is buying crypto-related stocks. So we're going to spend a lot of time going through each of those options in depth today. And Brian, it'd be great if you could just start us off with the first one.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Jim. So starting with buying coins or tokens directly through a crypto exchange or a traditional investment platform. So generally, a crypto exchange may offer a wide variety of investment choices where a traditional platform may offer fewer coins and tokens, but will have the convenience of having your crypto and your other investments all in one place. So broadly speaking, buying digital assets and coins directly gives you total control of your tokens and coins. That means you can use them as you want, trade them as you want, use them for purchases, maybe send them elsewhere. Basically, you're going to have that complete ownership of your digital assets. Now, that being said, that would mean you may have to manage aspects of your own security alongside that total ownership.
Yeah, perfect. So let's pause there for a second and just make that distinction, talking specifically about Fidelity Crypto as offered by Fidelity Digital Assets. The Fidelity Crypto account provides what's known in the industry as custody for a customer's cryptocurrency. So somebody, let's say, buys Ether, right? They can leave it in their Fidelity crypto account and get access to it just by using their traditional Fidelity login credentials. So a Fidelity crypto customer does not necessarily then have to worry about maintaining a seed phrase or protecting a physical cold wallet. So, and just to make sure everybody's on the same page here with terminology, a seed phrase in this context is essentially your password. So in crypto, it's a string of a dozen or 24 random words that you have to save and then provide in order to access your assets. Again, that's something that you have to worry about if you self-custody your crypto, like if you move it off of the exchange where you bought it. And a cold wallet is just the term for a piece of hardware. It's typically like a small hard drive or something like that in which you can store your seed phrase. It's called cold if it's not connected to the internet versus a hot wallet, which is connected to the internet. A hot wallet is online. But again, Brian, all of that is something that maybe someone who invests with Fidelity Crypto doesn't necessarily have to worry about.
Yeah, exactly right. So Fidelity Digital Assets will secure customer assets on their behalf. Never lending out those assets, never taking loans on those assets. You know, Fidelity Digital Assets simply holds those digital assets, those Bitcoin, those units of Ethereum, until the customer wants to sell or trade those assets. But to be clear, to your earlier point, some platforms, you know, allow you to move your digital assets to your own private wallets or self-hosted wallets. And that's where you need to worry about those seed phrases, lost devices, lost passwords, things like that.
Cool. And one more quick note about custody and security. We just did a full live stream episode about the many choices people have when it comes to where and how to store and secure their crypto. It's something we get a ton of questions about all the time. That's episode 36 of the live stream. And you'll see a lot more details about the security offered by Fidelity Crypto there as well. So you can find episode 36 of the live stream either on Fidelity's YouTube page or on fidelity.com/learncrypto. But with that, I'll turn it over to Sophie to talk about the second way people can get exposure.
Perfect. Thanks, Jim. So the second way that you can get exposure to buy a crypto is to buy a crypto ETP, which stands for an exchange traded product, or crypto related ETFs, which stands for exchange traded funds. So this can be done on a brokerage platform, which is pretty convenient. So ETPs offer exposure to the performance of a specific cryptocurrency. So for example, Bitcoin, while ETFs can offer exposure to a basket of cryptocurrency related stocks or futures. Either one of these can be held in traditional brokerage accounts, which is pretty nice. So this route gives you exposure to crypto's market movements and volatility without needing to manage that security of the cryptocurrency itself. And yes, we'll break down the differences between ETPs and ETFs in a moment. And the third way to invest in digital assets is to buy crypto-related stocks. So just like any equity, these are shares of specific publicly traded companies in the crypto industry. Like with ETPs and ETFs, you don't actually own any coins, but instead, in this case, you own stock in a company that's actually connected to the crypto space.
Perfect. All right. So we've set the table there, which leads us logically to this great question as a follow-up from Matt, who wants to know what the benefits and risks are of investing directly in crypto versus, for example, the Bitcoin ETP and other ETFs. So another great question, Matt. We will get you covered here by talking about the potential pros and cons of all of your options. And Brian, we'll have you start us off with that too, please.
Yep, absolutely. So pros and cons of buying and trading crypto coins directly. So first off, this is a relatively straightforward way to gain exposure to the actual cryptocurrency that you're interested in. And some people may prefer this buying directly because once your account is set up, it's pretty simple to get exposure to the digital asset space. It may only take minutes to execute your first buy order out there. I'd also advocate in some ways for learning by doing. Lots of people, myself including, over many years, learn to understand the crypto space more when they actually start diving on. And one way to dive in may be to buy or sell, even in small amounts. So just that act of entering an order gives you a little bit of a hands-on experience in this process. And that can be useful for better understanding the overall crypto ecosystem over time. Another example I'd say is that buying crypto outright does give you that complete custody over your coins and tokens. I like to say choose your own adventure in many ways, and that total ownership gives you a little bit more of that aspect. So you may be able to transfer between your wallets, your personal crypto counts. And side benefit of this as well is a little bit more of that learning by doing, by actually, you know, having that ownership and trying things out. You're going to understand more and more about how that blockchain technology works, assuming that's something you're interested in, is a little bit of a nice bonus alongside your transactions. And finally, I'll say, you know, crypto is open all the time. So that's 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And generally, there's more flexibility on platforms to directly buy and sell coins compared to traditional assets like stocks and ETFs. Stocks and other products, you know, you may only be able to buy and sell those Monday through Friday, 9:30 a.m. through 4 p.m.
Got it. All right. Those are the potential pros. Got to balance out the conversation with the cons.
Yep. It's always a balance in picking what's right for you. And some of those pros I just listed also have aspects of a con as well. So, you know, firstly, we've talked about, you know, taking that full ownership, but also gives you a little bit more responsibility, particularly for the custody and security on your coin. So depending on where you buy your crypto, you may also have to decide where and how you want to protect those digital assets and then actually provide that security as well, particularly in this self-hosted situation that we talked about before. So this is where you transfer your coins to your own private hot or cold wallets. And that's where you have the chance of, if you lose that device, lose your private key, forget your password, something gets destroyed accidentally, you're likely out of luck. There's not a customer service number you can call to help you out there. Your assets may be gone forever. So just a reminder, though, like we said a minute ago, Fidelity Digital Assets offers custody for your crypto. So those self-hosted risks aren't necessarily a concern if you're buying from Fidelity Digital Assets. You know, another example here that we talked about as a benefit was the ability to transfer your coins elsewhere. Although I will also say, especially for people new to crypto, but for everyone, transferring coins on a blockchain is usually a multi-step process. And even small errors along the way could result in you losing either losing assets or doing something accidentally. And, you know, next up, like everything in the online world, and certainly like other digital assets, crypto is vulnerable to theft and scams. No shortage in the news of scams and fraudsters out there, and they take advantage of beginners. They also take advantage of experts. Using a custodial product can help defend against some of these threats, but can't fully defend against all of those risks either. But there's definitely a custodian versus self-custody difference there as well. And then finally, I do want to note crypto assets are not insured by the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, which many of us know is the FDIC, which covers insurance for our bank accounts. Crypto assets are also not protected by the Securities Investor Protection Corporation, SIPC. That's the agency responsible for protecting some of your other accounts, like brokerage and retirement accounts, from insolvency of financial institutions. And finally, remember, crypto is highly volatile. There's always a possibility that the value of any coins or tokens you own can drop all the way to zero.
Exactly. All right. So before we move on to comparing direct buys to the other choices, I do definitely want to spend a few minutes clarifying, are those other choices ETPs or ETFs? Because Sophie, I know that a lot of people hear them used as synonyms, even in financial news, you hear them used as synonyms, but they're actually different. And MT's question gets to that. They ask, what are the differences between crypto stock ETFs and spot crypto ETPs? So Sophie, could you walk us through? They're not the exact same thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. So this is a really important distinction. So I'll start with ETPs, which stands for exchange traded products. So particularly in the crypto space, these are the investment options that have been creating so many big headlines and buzz in the news over the past several months. So you can think of ETPs really as the umbrella term that captures a pretty broad category of investment vehicles. And that includes ETFs, which I'll get to in a second here. So starting in early of 2024, this year, regulators began approving these crypto-related ETPs for the first time. This was a pretty exciting milestone for our industry. So spot Bitcoin ETPs were officially approved in January of this year, of 2024. So we use the word spot a lot. And spot in this case means that the ETP is built to track the current price of Bitcoin, which is also called the spot price. So a spot crypto ETP is a way for an investor to get price exposure to a cryptocurrency, but you don't actually have to own it directly, the way Brian was just explaining. So investors in ETPs can hold shares in most traditional brokerage accounts, including IRAs even, for example. So a spot Bitcoin ETP holds actual Bitcoins as its underlying investment, but only Bitcoins. That's the only asset in this product, which is important to note here. And so crypto prices have been quite volatile historically, and ETPs who only hold a single asset as they're holding are therefore also subject to a lot of the same price volatility as well. And so we just want to point out that there is this risk that the value of the cryptocurrency can fall to zero ultimately.
Absolutely. All right. So that covers off on the beginning part of what we're going to say about ETPs, exchange traded products. So next, if you could just walk us through ETFs, exchange traded funds, through the lens of the crypto industry.
Sure. So ETFs are investment options that have actually been around for many years, even in the crypto space. So this portion is nothing really new to our industry at this point. So ETFs, they are a subcategory of ETPs, and you can think of them as baskets of stocks, bonds, and really any other assets that are grouped together based on always a certain objective. So you've probably heard about ETFs for maybe specific industries or ETFs that track a specific index or maybe even a specific commodity. So in the crypto industry, you might find ETFs that have exposure to like mining companies, for example, or companies in the digital payment space or publicly traded crypto exchanges, for example. And because they hold a variety of assets, crypto ETFs are by definition a more diversified investment vehicle compared to crypto ETPs. And again, a crypto ETP gives you indirect exposure to the coin or token itself, where a crypto ETF gives you exposure to the stocks of companies connected to the industry overall. So they're pretty different. Mm-hmm. And ETPs can give investors definitely less direct exposure to the price of the cryptocurrencies, but they still experience similar volatility and risk associated with the crypto industry in general.
Yeah, for sure. Again, a good time to remind people once more that you often hear about spot crypto products being called ETFs, but technically, if the underlying asset is only the coin, Bitcoin, for example, that's an ETP, which is a great segue into this question that came into us during registration from a viewer named Dan, who says or asks, how does the spot Bitcoin ETP work? And do you actually own a percentage of the coin when investing in a spot Bitcoin ETP? Sophie?
Yeah, so the spot ETPs, they do hold actual Bitcoin as their underlying asset. But when you buy the ETP, I want to make this clear, you're not actually owning any of the underlying cryptocurrency. No. You own a share of a fund that seeks to track the cryptocurrency's price movements by holding only that cryptocurrency as its underlying asset. So going back to what we discussed a little bit earlier here, buying an ETP does not give you access to any of the underlying cryptocurrencies like monetary functions or utility, really outside of that just pure price exposure. So in other words, if you own a spot Bitcoin ETP, for example, you can't use that Bitcoin and take it to go pay for a good or service elsewhere. So you're sort of losing that utility by not owning the underlying token itself in the direct way that Brian mentioned earlier. So with the actual ETP, you're not owning the Bitcoin, you're really just owning part of a larger fund that holds all of that Bitcoin.
Got it. Okay, so let's go back actually to finish answering MT's question from a few minutes ago, asking us to evaluate these options overall. And a nice question, I think, to supplement that one with is another one from a registrant named Jeff, who asks, is it better to invest in an ETF or ETP or buy actual coins? And I'm smiling because, Jeff, I hear you, I appreciate you, but we are definitely never going to get into a position where we attempt to tell you which one is better, right? That's completely subjective. It's very much up to you to decide, you know, which option makes the most sense for you based on your goals. But what we definitely can do for Jeff and for everyone else is some comparing and contrasting. And let's start actually, Sophie, with you by talking about the buying process.
Sure. So with an ETF or an ETP, it's pretty simple. You just log into your brokerage account and you can place an order just like you would for a traditional stock or bond, and you're done. So the process should be very familiar. It's relatively simple and should look just very similar to placing any type of trade that you've done in your brokerage account before. And you can access these assets using your standard brokerage account login or password. So same account, same experience, just placing an order for one of these specific products.
Now, comparing that to buying crypto directly, to do that, you'd likely need to establish a new crypto account if you don't already have one. Sure. Once you're set up with that crypto account, as I said a few minutes ago, usually you can be up and running in as few as a couple minutes. But again, if you want to go further and do something like self-custody, which means you'd actually want to move your funds out of that crypto account somewhere else, that's where you'd have to worry about the additional where, how you'll protect and store your digital assets, creating additional wallets, understanding how the blockchain works, protecting your freeze phrases, things like that, if you elect to do that further step.
Got it. Another thing for Jeff and others to consider, again, doing this comparing and contrasting, is how often you might want to trade inside your account.
Yeah, so this is a situation where you might find ETFs or ETPs have some more limitations compared to owning coins directly. So how I like to think about it is both choices, ETF and ETP, have the word traded right in their name. So exchange traded fund, exchange traded product. And this can be an easy way to remember that you can only make a move when the market is open. So you can only buy and sell ETPs and ETFs during market hours. So that's weekdays, Monday to Friday from 9:30 in the morning to 4 p.m. Eastern. And the market is closed on holidays. So if you're interested in making a trade for a cryptocurrency that you like, let's say on Friday at 5 p.m. or on Saturday morning or on Christmas Day or New Year's Day, you might not be able to capture those gains or cut your losses until the market opens back up again on Monday or on the next open market day.
Yeah, and here's where buying directly may be able to help you move faster if you need to or want to. So the crypto market, as we talked about earlier, it never closes. It's global, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. So if you want to buy or sell at, 10 o'clock at night on a holiday, you wake up on Thanksgiving morning and you want to trade crypto, say maybe you're a weekend trader and that's where you have time to do more of your research, buying crypto directly, generally, you will be able to make your trades at various times of day outside of those, limited Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 4 p.m. market hours. There's plenty of examples out there where, Bitcoin, as an example, has had price movements of 10% just over a weekend. Yeah. That's where an ETP investor would have to wait until the market opens on Monday if they want to enter or exit any of their positions. One caveat that's worth mentioning there is, even though the overall crypto market 24/7, individual crypto exchanges may have their own downtime or be closed for platform updates, maintenance based on their own hours. But generally, you will have more options in terms of when and where you place a trade in buying crypto directly.
All right. Next topic, although we know for sure Fidelity does not offer tax advice, we can definitely still point to a tax related distinction in the context of this conversation. So, Brian, what can we say here?
Yeah, thanks, Jim. That's a very good call out. When someone buys or sells coins or tokens directly, they will be responsible for keeping track of all of their taxable events and reporting them to the IRS come tax time. So anyone who buys or sells cryptocurrencies has to keep track of their cost basis, what they originally paid for these coins, and then report any profits or losses that they experience during the tax year. Unfortunately, a lot of crypto exchanges don't offer much help when it comes to tax times. It's going to be up to each person to maintain their own records, whether it's hopefully not pen and paper, but maybe a spreadsheet on a file on their computer, things like that. Although I will point out that Fidelity Digital Assets does have a report available each year called Game Loss Summary. That's where, you know, it'd be available online in your account if you've made any trades with us in the past year. But Fidelity Digital Assets does not send that summary to the IRS themselves. It'd be up to each customer to use that report as they need.
So I'll be honest, it's a little more straightforward when it comes to tax reporting for the ETPs and ETFs. So typically, your brokerage company will report gains and losses directly to the IRS. And this is a standard practice. Again, if you've traded stocks or other investments in your brokerage account, you're probably used to your provider issuing some type of end of year tax statement to you and to the IRS. And so even when the underlying assets in those investments are crypto related, like the ones we've been talking about today, they're still investment vehicles themselves. And so they're still treated as securities in terms of tax reporting. So it'd be just as standard like your other brokerage assets.
Got it. Okay. One last thing I will add real quickly is that investors should also consider that ETPs don't track the price of the underlying cryptocurrency perfectly, right? So a spot Bitcoin exchange traded product, again, holds only Bitcoin as its underlying asset. So buying that ETP does allow you to get exposure to the coins, let's call it big picture price moves, but the ETP won't necessarily always reflect those moves on a one-to-one basis. That's due to several reasons. Management fees are among them, rebalancing costs and delays, and other factors as well. So it's another good thing to keep in mind when you're comparing and contrasting your options. I think this next question from Gerard has a similar answer, but it's worth revisiting again. And Brian, I'll send this your way. Gerard wrote in when he registered and said, I bought Bitcoin via Fidelity Crypto before the SEC's approval of the spot Bitcoin ETPs. What's the difference between the two purchase methods? So here you have, this is exactly what we've been talking about in some ways, buying it directly through Fidelity Crypto versus the option of buying it through a brokerage account through Fidelity in ETP. What can you say?
Yep. So if someone buys spot Bitcoin through Fidelity Crypto, which is provided by Fidelity Digital Assets, then you own actual cryptocurrency. Right. And Fidelity Digital Assets will custody those Bitcoins plus those fractions of Bitcoins known as Satoshis on your behalf, but the actual tokens themselves. If you bought the spot Bitcoin ETP, as Sophie was detailing earlier, you're buying a share of a fund that seeks to track the price movements of Bitcoin. So you don't own that Bitcoin directly, but of course, since, as Sophie detailed, the only underlying asset in that ETP is Bitcoin, you would have that indirect exposure. In terms of the purchase methods, which I think was Gerard's question, again, I'd echo what Sophie's saying. You can buy actual Bitcoin in a Fidelity Crypto account, but then you'd buy the ETP or an ETF in your brokerage account. So that brokerage account would be offered by Fidelity Brokerage Services, which is a small but meaningful distinction that we should make. Fidelity Brokerage Services does not offer direct sales of digital assets. That's through Fidelity Crypto, offered by Fidelity Digital Asset Services, LLC.
Got it. Okay, cool. Thanks for that distinction as well. Another specific question from Tedford now. Sophie, I'll throw this one your way. What's the difference, Tedford asks, between FDIG, sometimes called FDIG, and FBTC, which is the spot Bitcoin ETP?
Sure. So I think another way to ask this question a little bit more generally is like, what's the difference between a crypto-related ETF and a spot crypto ETP at Fidelity specifically? So as you referenced, so FDIG, bear with me, is the Fidelity Crypto Industry and Digital Payments ETF. So this basically tracks the price movements of a basket of crypto-related companies that are selected for this fund. So for example, FDIG, it includes stocks of large crypto exchanges and mining companies specifically. On the other hand, FBTC, so it's actually pretty different. So this seeks to track the price movements of specifically Bitcoin. As we mentioned before, it's a spot Bitcoin exchange traded product. So I think if you're looking at the two different options, really the underlying assets for these funds are fundamentally different. And FDIG, as I mentioned, is a crypto ETF. It's a basket of stocks related to the crypto space, where FBTC, on the other hand, is a spot Bitcoin ETP that is just holding actual Bitcoin.
Thank you for that. And totally respect for anybody watching right now, feeling like the acronyms and abbreviations can get confusing. So before we move on, I'll hit it at a high level again, really quickly. Again, all ETFs are part of a broader category called exchange-traded products, ETPs, which are listed on an exchange and can be bought and sold during market hours, just like a stock. ETFs are the most common type of ETP, and they're governed by the Investment Company Act of 1940. They're pooled investment opportunities that typically include, as we've said, baskets of stocks, bonds, and other asset groups that are based on fund objectives. FBTC is similar to an ETF since FBTC trades on an exchange. However, FBTC is an ETP that it holds 100% Bitcoin and doesn't invest in securities. So therefore, FBTC, the exchange-traded product, is not subject to the Investment Company Act of 1940. There's a transcript that will be available after this broadcast. A replay will also be available. We'll talk more about that in a second, because you're not alone if you want to take a second pass at that. We're about to shift to live customer questions in just a second, but the final option we're going to cover when it comes to getting exposure to the crypto space is just buying the stock of a company or companies you're interested in. Sophie?
Yeah, so this is pretty straightforward. You'll want to do your research, as always, because this is a super volatile industry, but you're free to buy individual stocks in your brokerage account. So maybe you think a particular company has an innovative solution when it comes to crypto mining, for example, or say there's a company investing in a new payments technology that's really exciting and interesting to you. So truly, there's no shortage of investment ideas. But just remember that even though you're not exposed to actual crypto this way, it's still quite a volatile and risky industry. So your investment is still subject to that overall risk, just maybe in a little bit more of a distant way. And plus, when you're building your portfolio yourself, it's always a good idea to try to diversify your holdings. An investor could easily find themselves with a pretty aggressive portfolio. And I mean, hey, that's okay, potentially, as long as they're aware of the risks and that level of aggression matches their investment personality and truthfully their timeline at the end of the day. ETFs, for example, may be able to offer a more diversified way into this space, but I'll be a broken record. Like we said earlier, you're limited to trading within market hours, but you do get that traditional tax reporting associated with your brokerage account, which is a nice plus on that end.
Got it. All right. Hey, Sydney, we're about ready to turn it back over to you. And yeah, I'm sure there's more than a little bit of an element of broken recordness throwing that vibe throughout the show, but that's fine, I think, because this is not a necessarily easy concept to get your head around. So let's see if we can clear up anything else from any live questions that came in.
Thanks, Jim. Yeah, we got a lot of great questions in today. Cool. This one might be good for you and Sophie. So Poulin notices that the Fidelity ETP, the FBTC, is purely Bitcoin-based, but he's noticing how it does not move in tandem with Bitcoin and in that specific proportion. Why is that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Sophie, want to take a swing at that? Right, so Bitcoin price moves, right, sometimes quite dramatically, and an FBTC will follow, but it's not, as I said earlier, not one for one, not matched exactly every single price movement along the way. But Sophie, take another shot if you could at explaining why that is.
Yeah, so there are quite a few factors that go into why FBTC may not track one to one exactly to the price movements of Bitcoin. But some factors that come to mind quickly are just due to their management fees that are involved with managing this fund. There are also rebalancing costs that the team is kind of actively working with daily to rebalance the fund. There are delays really with like how the fund performs versus the market. And there's some other factors, but those are the big ones that come to mind here.
I'd say also, and this is what Brian was talking about too, and Sophie, please correct me if I'm wrong, but right, the Bitcoin market, for example, is moving at 5 p.m. on a Tuesday and at midnight on a Wednesday. And so FBTC, the Bitcoin spot ETP, has a necessary lag because it's not going to reflect any changes at least until the market opens the following morning. So you've got maybe 12 hours longer there sometimes.
Exactly. Yeah, that's a great point.
Great. Okay. Sid, what's up? What else?
Yeah, we've got Aries back. I know we've addressed some of his in the past. He's curious today on how we would look at diversifying a crypto portfolio.
That's a good one. Sophie, anything come to mind? I mean, I think so you sort of answered that with your last question with an ETF. Maybe talk more about that if you could.
Yeah, I think just like as we've pointed out during the course of this session today, like there are many different ways to get access to crypto. Like we talked about, there's the direct method through a Fidelity Crypto account, for example, where you can actually own Bitcoin and Ethereum. There's the ETP that we mentioned, which again, just holds Bitcoin in this case so far. And then there are the ETFs, which essentially are baskets of stocks that are related to the crypto industry. And so I think if you could mix all three methods of getting exposure, the ETFs, like I mentioned most recently, are the most diverse way to get exposure. As you're holding just stocks that are related to the crypto industry, you're not actually holding the tokens themselves. But I think in all three cases, there's certainly risk in this industry. And so just being able to measure that risk and invest accordingly is probably the best advice I can give there.
And my gut tells me that Aries has, as a regular viewer of the live stream, probably already knows this, but for those who want a refresher, it's just good to remember, you know, crypto in specific, as we've said, is volatile and risky. So measure that against your own personal goals, right? Relative to how much time you want to have in the market, how much, you know, you're comfortable with waking up in the morning and seeing your investment level maybe having dropped 10, 15, 20 or more percent. Can you stomach that? Is that something that you want to wait through, ride through? You know, be really honest with yourself about how much volatility and risk you can personally take and absorb. And that, I think, will help you figure out the level of crypto that you might want to hold in a portfolio and then figure out diversification along those lines with an honest assessment of what you can handle in a very risky space. Anything else, Sid?
Yeah, we got one here from Gary. So he is asking, how do you think the finite nature of Bitcoin impacts its potential as an investment?
Ooh, that's a good one. Sophie, Brian? So Bitcoin, just as a refresher for folks who aren't aware, the way the Bitcoin's code was written is that it is meant to be a finite, scarce resource. There will never be more than 21 million Bitcoins in existence. And, you know, Bitcoin proponents will tell you that's a great thing, right? That's going to help it increase its value. But what do you guys, not increase its value, but help it have and maintain its value and maybe even be deflationary? What do you guys think?
I can take a stab and then Brian, feel free to chime in. I think it's a simple case of supply and demand. And so as supply now in this case is limited and maybe demand increases, that certainly could, not saying it does, but could drive up the value of this investment. I think about it similarly to real estate in maybe highly sought after locations. Like there's a finite amount of land, unless you're like filling in land in a river, another body of water, which in Boston, we experience that. But in general, land is finite. The space to build real estate is finite. And hence, you can see more demand to live in those areas. And then you see the price of those assets increase as well. So I think about it like supply and demand. And I think it can be applied to this asset class as well. But Brian, happy to hand it over to you if you have anything to add.
Yeah, no, I think those are all great points. And it all goes down to also kind of couples with the diversification question of what are you trying to accomplish with your investments? What is the investment case that you're looking at? And then comparing the different things, whether it's a stock, an ETP, Bitcoin, Ethereum, or other blockchains that all have, you know, different mechanisms to make up your investment case. And of course, just a reminder, we're not going to offer price predictions on this live stream.
Or ever. Right. Exactly. And one final caveat, because I want to go back to Sydney for another question that is worth calling out. You know, so Bitcoin does have that supply cap, but that's not necessarily true of other cryptocurrencies that you may encounter. For example, it's not true of Ether, right? The Ethereum blockchain doesn't have for Ether that same restriction. There's mechanisms by which new Ether tokens enter and exit through a process called burning, which we talk about in other live streams. But I think that the big picture takeaway here is Bitcoin does famously have a supply cap, but that's not necessarily true for all coins and tokens in the space. Just worth, I think, saying out loud again, because a lot of times we use Bitcoin and crypto as synonyms, and they're definitely not the exact same thing. Crypto is a big, 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 big word. Sydney?
Yeah, we've got a question here from Dinesh and truly from several other people that seem to be new to Fidelity Crypto.
Yeah.
So Dinesh is asking, what coins Fidelity is offering currently? And I've seen some questions on eligibility as well.
Eligibility in terms of how do you get to take part?
Yeah. So who can open a Fidelity crypto account?
Sure. All right. I'll take a stab at both of those. They're both pretty straightforward. So right now, Fidelity Crypto gives customers the opportunity to buy and sell both Bitcoin and Ethereum. I will also say that the product itself, the offering of Fidelity Crypto, is still relatively new. And we do hear from customers and potential customers all the time that they'd love for us to expand our offering beyond Bitcoin and Ethereum. So all I can say at this point is we absolutely hear you. And an expansion of what we offer is certainly on the roadmap. I just really can't share anything in terms of a timeline. But so right now, the answer is Bitcoin and Ethereum, and the product we hope will evolve. The other question was about eligibility, a fantastic question. You can open a Fidelity crypto account with a couple of caveats. First, you have to be a United States citizen, and you have to live in a state where Fidelity Digital Assets does business. And so right now that is 38 states. Sydney, does that sound right? Is it 38? That number also goes up as well. Yeah, it goes up with time as well. Mm-hmm. And Fidelity Digital Assets is, again, working to expand and grow that list to the greatest extent possible. But at the moment, it's 38 states. And you can head over to fidelity.com/learncrypto, where you'll see a list of FAQs. Another great resource too is just fidelity.com/crypto. And then the FAQ section of that page, fidelity.com/crypto, will have some more information about what states Fidelity Digital Assets does business in right now. And that'll help you figure out if in fact you do live in a state where you can open an account.
Great. Thanks. Do we have time for one more, Jim?
Yeah. I mean, we've got technically 4 full minutes left, so we can squeeze a couple more in. That'd be good.
Awesome. All right. Well, Megan asked, how does buying Bitcoin on Fidelity directly differ from buying it on another exchange?
Oh, that's a toughie. I'm not sure how much we can answer about that, right? I mean, Brian or Sophie, I don't know how I'd answer that one. My experience is with one.
Yeah, I agree. I think, some of the things we can share is, that common experience. So that same username, password, and two-factor credential you use to access other Fidelity products is also your entryway into your Fidelity crypto account. Similarly, the same, you can see your Fidelity Digital Assets accounts generally in same overviews as you can some of your other accounts. Other crypto exchanges, that's likely a brand new relationship with a brand new company that you may not already have established.
Yeah, that's a good call out. We hear that a lot from a ton of customers who appreciate the ability to have that view be all in one place. So I would say that's one thing that jumps to mind. All right, Sid, we can do a couple more if we got them.
Yeah, let's see. Alfred has a two-part question that I really like today. So is crypto a viable component of a long-term diversified portfolio? That's part one. Mm-hmm. And which market asset do we believe crypto positively is correlated to?
Ooh, the macro one. That's hard. I'm gonna look longingly at both Brian and Sophie for that one. But I'll take, can you hit me with the first half of Alfred's question again? Because I can take that one.
Yeah. So Alfred's first portion here is crypto a viable component of a long-term diversified portfolio?
Yeah, viable for me is a funny verb, Alfred. So I guess that really ultimately comes down to your discretion and your age and your risk tolerance. I will say that, it's something that someone who, again, is very much open to risk and probably has a long-term outlook might consider Bitcoin, again, if they can, or any crypto, might consider it in their portfolio, recognizing it's going to have an outsized effect on volatility, right? It's going to make your depending on your percentage, it's going to make your portfolio swing a lot more because it is such a volatile asset. So is it something that you want to consider? That has everything to do with how you've constructed your portfolio. If you have what you would consider to be a fairly unaggressive, relatively, quote unquote, safer, calmer basket of goods, a basket of investments in your portfolio, then maybe the introduction of something that has more volatility is something that you're looking for. Again, an incredibly personal decision. Similarly, if you have what you would consider to be already very aggressive portfolio, like Sophie was talking about a few minutes ago, the introduction of cryptocurrencies into that might bring you to a higher level of volatility than you're comfortable with. Or it might not. I mean, I'm sorry. I mean, it's hard without like knowing your exact situation. I mean, maybe you're someone who just wants to be, you know, bury the needle when it comes to volatility and risk. That's an option too. But ultimately, these are all really, really personal decisions that it's kind of hard. We'll do our best to answer them, but kind of hard to answer in a broadcast like this. What was the second half of this question, though?
Is the market asset part of it. So which market asset do we feel crypto positively correlates to?
I can answer that by not answering it at all. And this is, I think, one of the most interesting parts of Bitcoin and other cryptos is everyone kind of has their own opinion. And it really does have different aspects of a whole bunch of different asset classes. And there's many will disagree on that. Some think it's more like a currency. Some think it's an inflation hedge. Some thinks it's more like a high growth, high risk tech stock. There's many different aspects of Bitcoin, and there's even more aspects of other cryptocurrencies that there's certainly, you know, lively debate out there. So it's really do your own research and figure out where it fits into your own personal goals.
Right. Sometimes the non-answer is actually the answer to give. So thanks for that. As we wrap up, I know we all often get questions about how to rewatch a show like this. And I already alluded to this as well. So just a reminder, this episode will be available as a replay, which you can find both on fidelity.com/learncrypto, where there will also be a transcript available for download as well. It's also going to be available on our YouTube page. So give us about a week or so to get things up and running there. And we'll get the rebroadcast of this show on both on YouTube and on fidelity.com/learncrypto. If you registered for this show, you will get an email thanking you for attending, and then also an email when that replay is available. So we'll take care of you there. You just have to wait for it to show up in your inbox, and the replay with a link to the transcript will show up there as well. All right. I want to thank all three of you for making time to be with us today.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, everyone.
A real quick reminder as we go, there's a brief survey under the video player where your questions were just coming in. Takes less than 2 minutes to fill that survey out, and it helps us a ton in terms of planning for future episodes. So we appreciate you doing that. Remember, you can visit fidelity.com/learncrypto for more crypto videos, infographics, articles. And in fact, you can also sign up for our next Covering Crypto live stream there as well. Episode 40 is coming up on August 13th. We're going to be talking about reading crypto charts. We're going to be looking at how one navigates and makes sense of cryptocurrency charts. We'll walk you through several of the most common charts and break down how you can use them to help you build your crypto confidence. So as always, send us your questions when you register for that or while you're watching live. Thanks for joining us today, and we hope to see you soon.